In the conversation zone today, we are joined by a subject matter expert.
Welcome.
Why, thank you for having me.
Well, thank you for joining us. We're here to ask you specifically about the nature of your expertise. You are a renowned subject matter expert in so many areas. It's encyclopedic. It's encyclopedic. It's encyclical. It's voluminous.
Encyclopedic? Is that what you're trying to say, sir?
Yes. You are one of few subject matter experts who travel the world pronouncing your expertise. How did you become a subject matter expert?
That all occurs just one step at a time. Baby steps. Perhaps you've read my book.
Yes, in fact, on page 165, you say, and I quote, "Little feet take smaller steps." What about the relationship between the foot and the mouth? I observed your manner of speaking. You do not use an uptick at the end of your sentence.
When people use an uptick, it implies that they really don't know what they're talking about.
Are you implying that when a person uses an uptick that they know very little, and this lack of self-esteem, self-confidence is what causes the end of the sentence to sound like a question?
That's exactly what I'm alluding to. And these individuals have a difficulty with their self-esteem.
You travel the world dispensing all manner of expertise. My question to you is, for example, when the wait person, whether that be a man or a woman or other, is waiting on the table, if my companion, not to imply that the person I have dinner with is my partner, not necessarily my companion or my mate, but the person that I'm sitting with at the table, if I see that that person is not quite ready to order and the waiter or the waitress, regardless of their gender identity, asks what we're having, I will glance at the person with whom I am seated and...
Well, if I could just break in here for just a moment. I know that I'm the interviewee and you are the interviewer.
Well, I was attempting to take as much time as I can to ask you an innocuous question.
I think this whole entire interview has been a fine example of that. To be able to understand at that depth, I think it takes a great amount of reflection.
When I was very young, my father would put me in the trunk of the car and drive around and stop the car, open the trunk and remove the road flares, light them, throw them on the road, throw me back in the trunk, slam the door and drive off. Just in a normal course of a weekend, I might have had this experience 5 or 6 times. My mother, on the other hand, would put her head out the window and yodel as the car was in motion. But when my father stopped the car and took me out of the trunk, removed road flares, lit them, and hurled them across the roadway, my mother would no longer be yodeling.
It must have just been spectacular.
As a subject matter expert, my question to you would be, would you recommend phosphorus road flares if you were to hurl such devices, or would you rather use light-emitting diodes?
I'm a fan of the phosphorus grenade-type flare that is quite bright. The flash is just incredible.
Thank you for joining us.
Why, thank you for having me.
Support for National Taxpayer Radio comes from the Political Wacko Foundation, guaranteeing job security for lifelong politicians for the purpose of remaining in office indefinitely. Additional support is provided by the Stop the Statesman Foundation, preventing statesmen from being elected to office to serve their term before returning to normal life. Thank you.